Chair. Hello, everybody. Thanks for being here. We're going to do this as sort of a workshop to make sure you can benefit your input. I'm happy to let you know some of the developments. This is our fifth meeting, I believe. We've been all over the state, which sometimes makes it a challenge to get everybody here in one place, but we're trying to make sure the citizen commission is getting the most engagement from citizens around the country. One of our earlier meetings realized the masses of information needed for the commission to serve the public in a good way in terms of fulfilling the mandate of voters in the most responsible and best way. The one that I've been asked to report on is trying to get all of the information we can for this body and public around the amounts and ways of money. So on the money in politics piece of information that we're bringing forward, we've established folders to collect all that information to be available to the public. So we're getting secondary reports. A lot of work has already been done around how money in politics moves. We don't need to reinvent that field. We want to make sure all that information is available to the commission and the public as we move forward to fulfill the mandate and the report that we're due by the end of this year. We are getting input from the public, whoever wants to, and many of you have taken us up on that, so thank you for that. We received a memo regarding some summary data that's available at places like openseekers.org, which is federal, mostly federal numbers around elections for Senate, Congress, which is the federal races, again, from the Federal Election Commission. Very useful. I recommend it to all if you're interested. openseekers.org, and then there's a group called followthemoney.org, the National Institute on Money and Politics, and that really focuses on state elections, state data. And just some summary that I will report today, between 2006 and 2019, in federal Massachusetts elections, it totaled $638.22 million, so nearly $631 million. Contributed to various federal campaigns and candidates in that time period. In 2006, it was $33 million plus. In 2018, another midterm election was $136 million, so over $100 million more in that time span. The percentage of adult population that makes contributions to campaigns and candidates of over $200 is 0.61%. So almost none of the population of Americans are actually making contributions of over $200, and the percentage of the money that is in the system of those contributions that comes from contributions over $200 is 71%. So some of the data we're finding confirms the sense that most of the money is coming from relatively few contributors. On the state candidate side, in Massachusetts state campaigns, again, in that same time period, 2006 to 2019, and you're going to have to write this all down via attached to the minutes for this meeting online to the public. Total contributions to Massachusetts state candidates in that time period, 2006 to 2019, total election cycle was $862 million. Again, the numbers that were reported to us based on those sources, filing, including OCDF here in Massachusetts, 89% of that money in the 2018 cycle came from contributions of $200 or more, and 66% of that money came from contributions of $1,000, which is the maximum Massachusetts races now. So that's just some of the just snapshots out of a lot more data that we're gathering together, and we'll continue to review that here. It's a massive amount of research in a very short time for the commission to do a meaningful, useful job on this. And so we've been, again, blessed to have many any volunteers step forward and offer their expertise. Liz Tai, Dr. Liz Tai, research scientist at Brandeis University, has volunteered to help with some of the data analysis and bringing that forward to us to get the data coming from federal and state sources that I mentioned. We've been talking to individuals as well who are experienced in the system to get their views, including members of Congress, political fundraisers, political operatives, and professors. We are blessed to have our chair, a professor with a lot of knowledge in this area, and there are others as well. Dr. Maurice Cunningham, for example, at the University of Massachusetts, has worked in this field and is interested in sharing his work with the Commission. So we'll continue to look for that, those sources of information to bring it forward to here. These working groups aren't doing deliberation or decision making or voting on anything, so just trying to get the information to the Commission so that we can discuss and assess it in public forum. So thank you, Mr. Chair. I'll be happy to take any questions about the comment period later. Yeah, no, that's correct. And the background to that, the Citizens United decision, the most famous of many decisions that brought us to this question that we're all facing in this process, really concerned independent expenditure, so the so-called super PACs and other ways that non-campaign candidates spend money in elections. So that's a different category altogether. We're also getting information about that. Report on independent expenditures between in a similar time period up to 2016. Dr. Tai is trying to bring that forward to 2018, 2019. So I don't have numbers on that in the summary report, except to say it's a lot, but it's part of the mix of the different ways the money flows in. We'll be trying to address another report. Thank you very much.
Thank you. over at nassau.gov website, over the search feature type of citizens commission, that will bring you to the citizens commission webpage, and then towards the bottom of that page, you'll see a prompt. Want additional information, you click on that, that will bring you to the Google Drive repository, which are referred, and all that information will be visible for the public. So I'm happy to report that that is now enabled and accepted as this work.
Thank you very much. Let me also, just by way of update, say that Michael Harrington, who is appointed to this commission, has resigned from the commission, and so we will likely have a replacement coming out of the Secretary of State's office to the department. So at some point, we will be making a replacement appointment for that vacancy, and we will update you when it is, and more to come on that, point of order with 14 commissioners and 7 years, that has been part of the point to our understanding, we need a majority of our team, so we still we did think about that. So anyway, but thanks to the people for getting here, and do you want to give us a brief update on what you're working on? Here,
retirement.
The maximum number of discussion of what change.
Yeah.
Right. So we kind of did the Monday.
Yeah, yeah.
We did Mondays, I think, we did Mondays right now, September 16th, we have several people that said yes.
Yeah, so I, yeah, that's kind of a no on that.
So we are here about 49, but I have 6 people that have responded.
October 9th, that's,
that's
before it was against on the 8th.
Yes,
so October 9th, yeah.
We have October 9th, we actually have to. That's it, yeah.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, so citizens. Okay, so the commission on October 9th.
In this, that's the one that's already scheduled in this.
Yeah, you know, we might want to take a look and see if we want to go to Worcester.
The next commission meeting that we've talked about by email, is that going to be September 16th in Worcester?
No, no.
The October 9th meeting is what we anticipated in Worcester.
Okay.
So it will likely be in Boston, and it will probably be in Boston. Probably be in Boston.
Okay.
And that's when we're going to have a member of Congress at?
No.
Just similar to the scheduling issue, the working groups that are supporting some of these breakout committees, do they have official meetings that the members of the public can attend or can be provided with you, or are they only amongst the members of the
public? We have not had official meetings. We can gather information in the folder that we all share with the public. If we had a meeting where we're going to discuss all that, we notice that the public would be here. It hasn't been more information gathering to date. Charge to support people to gather information, explicitly told, you know, not to deliberate, vote, they have no authority that way to bring information forward. So that's been what we've been doing, but frankly, with August schedules, it's difficult to get any activity together, so we're trying to just get information. We have a shared folder to put it on.
The reason I ask when we talk about this occasion before is if we do get into some of the tactics that we just talked about, but when you really start this crafting, that requires an actual debate amongst people. You say, well, have you thought about this? It's hard to do that in mode, just on power level of people. So at the information level, I understand, but there comes a level very quickly. And you got anything we do, it very much appreciate. I very much appreciate you brought up very good process ideas.
Yeah.
And, I invite you to talk to David Rosenberg afterwards, too, about...
Well, can I unmute their phone?
About,
I'm hearing some background noise. Can everyone on the phone use their phone?
So,
it might be me.
So we have constraints around the public meeting. So any deliberation, like trying to do a vision, which needs to be public, like what would be this official meeting or public? Any I'm so clueless. Why?
Yeah. Any kind of deliberation of this body or an appointed subset for the purpose of deliberating to decide what the amendment should say, I think we all feel that would be something that we, at least if we're advised, but we'll always look at it. I'm not the expert on the meeting, but it's a challenge.
Thank you. the people to pressure Congress to propose an amendment to overturn citizens' mandate.
wording of the amendment proposal itself should not be watered down or in any way ambiguous, for instance, by using the word may instead of shall. Because the U.S. Congress, especially the U.S. Senate, is forced to take action in two following directions. Number one, initiate the first Article 5 convention in the history of our country. Versus two, propose a constitutional amendment to make it crystal clear that corporations are not people and that corporations do not have rights under the U.S. Constitution. Limited liability corporations already enjoy large protections against lawsuits precisely because they are not people and they have protection established in the coverage. LLCs are one of the reasons why public criminals go to jail. Corporations cannot have their name committed to, not be protected from lawsuits because they are corporations, and be treated as individuals in the courts when they so choose. No corporation should be allowed to sign a constitutional amendment. In a court case, Citizens United is selling the name of the president to violate the United States citizens' rights as people in the United States identified through the letter of the U.S. Congress. Our government should operate as good as people, not corporate. Thank you very much.
You have my copy of my testimony on some of this addressing for people here that already addressed. But I would like to say this.
Sorry, you changed names?
Yes, I
did. Thank you.
I want to
make sure we have it.
Okay.
I just want to make sure the commission has had your written statement.
Big corporations hurt the economy. Small businesses regard the power grab of large corporations as detrimental to their existence. One yellow is found, and he says, we don't pay the big guys either. In 2017, 58 businesses in Massachusetts signed a letter of support for the legal people. At a hearing in the Mass Legislature, a panel of businesses testified on behalf of the legal people.
I am Michael Gawala from the Quorum, Massachusetts. I'm with We the People, Massachusetts. I'm going to break my comments to avoid the numbers. I'm plus my testimony is in fact what I gave you. But I'll start by saying the fact that I gave you includes an explanation of artificial corporate legal personhood versus the constitutional right, a description of corporations that hijack the 14th Amendment when they're on the ground, other ways in which corporations have used the Bill of Rights as a weapon to overturn public interest laws, also why this is not part of the testimony, why not properly introduce the new constitutional rights, and a document of why we need support for the new People Amendment, given that the multinational corporations have lobbied governments to weaken the rights in unions organized and protected their workers' rights. The founders of the union is the Bill of Rights to protect the inherent and unalienable rights of human beings. The Bill of Rights is meant to protect the rights of individual unions from government power. Corporations were not mentioned in the Constitution or the Bill of Rights, so the founders knew and feared their power. Indeed, the revolution was partially a revolt against the British Charter Corporation. which controls voting. In 1868, the 14th Amendment reaffirmed that the state cannot deprive a person of life, liberty, or property without due process. In a perversion of this amendment's attempt, the corporate law was needed to assure that a corporate person would be privileged to the person who is human being, and that therefore corporations are entitled to constitutional rights. However, this is a complete fiction. I have been charged with caring real people to corporations. People are born to human parents and life from God. Corporations are created by charter and able to live forever. Real people need clean air, water, and food to live. Corporations only need money to function. Real people are capable of emotions. Corporations only care about maximizing profit. The recent statement by corporate CEO does not extend. Real people can be put in prison or executed. Corporations have limited liability. They can only be fined. All this means that corporate persons compete with us, real people, in a battle over sovereignty, over who owns the government. Right now, corporations are winning. And I will address a point that you made on the
Week up.
Thank you. That both liberal and conservative courts have ruled in favor of corporations over the rights of real people or the sovereignty of governments. So, constitutional amendment or the repeal of the constitutional rights for corporations and for money should not be held hostage in the current or any future court. Thank you.
So I'm Sam Piacetti. I live in North Brookfield. And I didn't prepare any remarks since we have time today to hear and say a couple of things. So I live in a small rural town, and it may seem as if money and politics wouldn't have an effect in a place like that, but it really does, first of all, because of the very deep and cross-partisan dissolution and dispirited feeling towards politics. The sense that it's controlled by powerful people you don't know, that it's out of your hands. And I've been involved a little bit in some local political campaigns. And you see the effect of money in politics in a kind of invisible way, because as soon as someone says, well, I'm thinking about running for state house, or this person I know is thinking of running for mayor of Worcester, you immediately have to think, well, where am I going to get the money, and how much money is my opponent? And it blocks, it discourages many people from even trying in the first place. And so I'm sure you're going to gather a lot of data and a lot of numbers about does it affect the outcomes of campaigns and so forth. But I think there's an invisible effect there, even of money that isn't necessarily spent, because it prohibits, it creates this barrier where people feel like they can't even get involved in the first place. And the other thing, I'm an adjunct professor of history, and I just know that where Article 5 came from. It began as part of the Virginia Plan, right at the beginning of the Constitutional Convention, proposed by Madison and Portuguese, where they said there should be a process for amending the Constitution. And their proposal was the states should have the power to propose amendments and if the courts approved, they should be ratified. And it was only later on in the process that Hamilton said, well, Congress should also be able to propose as well. And that was added on as kind of a second thought. But the original idea, which basically all the delegates agreed on, was the states should have this power. And there should be someone outside Congress, outside the federal government, who can initiate this process. So I just think if you're looking at what's a proper channel through which to pursue an amendment, that was the idea of the referendum.
Guardrails,
to the road to a more perfect union. The Constitution provides guardrails to keep our government on the road to a more perfect union, where our elected representatives serve the interests and reflect the will of the people. The 27th Amendment provides additional guardrails not found in the original Constitution. These additional guardrails address hazards to democracy. It became apparent as our nation evolves since the days before the right. Imagine what our country would be like in the absence of these additional guardrails. Slavery would still be legal. Women would not be eligible to vote. Poll taxes would prevent the poor from voting. Gun service men and women would not be eligible to vote in state and local elections. All but one of the 27 amendments read shall rather than may to indicate that they are mandatory, not optional. The 10th Amendment is the only one that does not read shall, but its language unequivocally limits the powers of the federal government. We now find ourselves in need of a new guardrail to ensure that our political leaders do not prioritize the interests of large corporations and billionaires over the interests of the people. We need a constitutional amendment that requires Congress and the states to enact meaningful campaign finance reform to ensure political equality and prevents incorporated entities from invoking the constitutional rights of real people to avoid compliance with democratically enacted laws. An amendment that merely allows such reforms without requiring them would not prevent self-serving special interests bent on maximizing profits from driving our country and our planet into the ditch. As a black man in the Civil War era, Frederick Douglass was an authority on the overcoming oppression. He said, "Power concedes nothing without a demand. It never did, and it never will. Find out just what any people will quietly submit to, and you have found out the exact measure of injustice and wrong which will be imposed upon them. And these will continue until they are resisted with either words or blows or both. The limits of tyrants are prescribed by the endurance of those whom they oppress." And Doris Granby had, who walked across America to support the bipartisan campaign for that in 2002, said, "I do not want to do away with corporations. I want them to make our cars, not our laws." A copy of my comments, along with the four other documents, are enclosed in the envelope for each one of you. These documents and more are all accessible at the link provided on the business card that is here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Great one. This is a question for the Commissioner. How close do you need to achieve the charter that's given by the voters? One reason I ask that is the charter requires us to consider both social principles and achieving the climate. Those two are not necessarily linked. For example, if one were to have sufficient campaign finance, say, just limiting the amount of money that any corporation or individual can choose $1,000, you may resolve most of the issues and not have to delve into the very deep waters around corporate personhood. Quite simple. And so, is it within, do you believe, or do you think about it, there are moments, do you believe that one can go back to the public if in your wisdom you believe that the right way to solve the problem, which is distortions of the democratic system and money, can be solved without addressing the corporate personhood? Or does the corporate personhood have to be connected to the language? Because it might be that you can find a simpler solution. Simple solutions are usually real hard for people to gain, which make it very complex. People find ways to go, for example, legally, everyone's a newspaper, and book brother buy a newspaper, just fails to buy a newspaper. You know, so sometimes the simpler solution is best, even if it's not exactly what the charter requested. I can't tell whether you're going to get away with that or not.
I won't claim to speak to the commission, but I think the charter speaks for itself, and that is what the public supporters were expressed in that. So even if this commission decides to move in the direction that focuses on one or the other, it will still be incumbent on us to explain how what we decided to addresses both of those concerns that the public that charter that creates the commission. So I don't think that there's any way to overlook the very clear direction provided to this commission by that charter. That's my view.
My name is Marie Hall, and I'm from Salem. I'm retired. A lot of people I've talked to about coming into the internet probably they've never heard anything about it from an engineer. But when I explore it, you know, they say, that's a no-brainer. Of course, that's what we need. But they're so jaded at this point that they said there's nothing you can do. So that's what a lot of us are fighting against now, is people who say, well, we really can't do anything now. The corporations have the power, and the more power the corporations get, the more money they get, the more power, of course, people will there. So, the thing that really disturbs me, like, one thing is that I want to know what's in my food. If there are chemicals in my food, we should all know exactly what they are. But Congress has given them the email that they don't need to, chemicals, even if they're carcinogenic, or if they believe they're maybe. Other thing, a climate problem as far as this upgrade would, and a lot of people. But I think that the money that's given to investors is directly related to a lot of the climate problems that we have now, and will continue to be in the region. And of course, directly related to concrete people, and then of course, rest from pork. So I know other people say artificial entities like corporations say, well, corporations need a right school. Well, but they have rights, the rights that we give them as artificial entities by the states. So they don't need additional rights given to them by the Constitution. Basically, that's another thing that bugs me is that if business is going to be investigated by OSHA or one of the government organizations, now they have to be warned. They can't do it just as a surprise because that's against the constitutional rights. So all these things affect us. I know they affect me. And I really like to see a very tough bill. And I think Massachusetts needs to step up to the plate. I don't know what's wrong with legislators who are afraid to pass the We the People Act. I don't know if it's fear, it's what it is, but it doesn't make sense to me. We need Massachusetts to take the lead. And I feel that if Massachusetts does pass it, some other states may also join in. Thank you.
My name is Tim Zerlau, I'm from Beverly, Massachusetts.
First of all, thank you for the work you're doing. Since, I mean, I'm here because all my family arguments about gun control, reproductive rights, they always end up as we have money out of politics. That's like seems to be the core thing that, you know, we can all agree on. So it's a fantastic task that you guys are tasked to, and I'm grateful that someone is doing it. I just had two questions that I'll pose and then a comment that came to mind as I was listening. One is that what is your plan or strategy for using the incredible intellectual resources of Massachusetts in your work? It seems like we are, you know, a lot of resources here, and people will volunteer, you know, a civic attitude is here. Just, is there a plan to tap them? And, the second is, I think regarding number five of the Carter, making those recommendations, is there a plan to solicit perspectives from state and federal lawmakers, especially Republicans, to determine a realistic feasibility of the various possible ways forward? It seems like we know a little bit that, you know, where some of the locks are, and, you know, is there a plan to get their perspective about what would make it better? The last thing is odd. I wanted to recommend two books that have helped me understand America better. One is The Righteous Mind, Why Good People Disagree About Politics and Religion by Jonathan Haidt. And the other, which is I'm definitely intensely passionate about, is American Nation, The 11 Rival Cultures That Make Up America by Colin Woodard. And I just offer these because as you're doing this work, it seems like there's a potential synthesizing that you're doing many different perspectives, and these books have really helped me understand the validity of other perspectives. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can you make sure that you get those comments in written format?
Sure. And then there's control
solve that problem, council was by using every tool at our disposal. The House of Representatives, lower class people, have been pushing for an amendment to cause direct election senators for decades at that point. And in 1901, we had the first Article 5 convention for that specific focus for direct election senators. Over the next 10 years, there were about 29 calls for Article 5 convention specifically for direct election senators. At the same time that activists were working on that solution, other activists were working on changing the policies in the states for the voting system, which created a non-binding resolution to essentially a primary that was non-binding, but was effective in convincing state legislators to appoint better senators. And ultimately, when it got to the point where there was newly admitted states that had already said that they were going to call for a convention, they were on the cusp of getting the two-thirds that they needed to get a convention before the amendment. Then, at that same time, because of the change in the Senate that was caused by the other forms of activism, that was enough to prompt them to actually call for the amendment themselves and the Senate finally passed the amendment to change how the Senate itself got there. And we saw after that, and along with the other forms, a period of several decades. We never had a golden age in American politics. We had a series of things that said we can improve. When there was a major scandal, like carpooling, we changed things. And we passed new laws. That started to change around 1976 and 1978 with Tucker v. Blair and the Black case, which was a Massachusetts case. And that led down the road to Citizens United and the American Tradition Partnership. And we follow the example of our whole project and all of the approaches at our disposal in order to solve this issue for another couple of generations, just like our 106 couple of generations now. They're going to be at the hearing of the Institute, who's going to be one of the contact persons to on our full-time convention process. That's Russell Kaplan. His book, Constitutional Partnership, is the best book I've seen on it. It's especially good for non-lawyers, and it's also the best way to see the lawyers. He's trying to make available to you guys for free of charge, but not able to do that. But I sent all of you an email that gives you links where you can find it in the library from the state, as well as the information for the $5 from the about $90. So I encourage you to look at that.
Dear Baron, I just wanted to stand up to thank everybody on both sides for was it the greater turnout?
Can I just ask, if you're in the audience, don't get a copy of Constitutional Partisanship right away. There's a limited number of copies that are easily accessible at low prices. So let the commissioners who want to acquire the easily obtainable copies. Thank you. Yes, but there's only a few at the libraries.
Any additional copies?
Thank you. way that can be personal. So I really know that I'm part of my family, citizen scientist. And in that role, I monitor links on the site a couple of ways, and we monitor things like temperature, daily life forms that can accumulate, how people are trained for this, especially in the U.S., and so forth and so on. I also volunteer at the and one of the things that I do as part of this role that I have is to monitor the environment on a very, very granular level. And what I would like to do, having done this over 2 years and having data at my disposal, is to go to some local legislators and say, this is what I'm observing, this is the data that I have collected. And I would love to be able to give you lots of money so that you could pass some legislation to help us keep the environment in the condition we want to keep it. But I'm not able to do that. I'm not doing this. This is not about money. This is about the insects, and it's about the plant life and the animal life in the lakes, and it is about our beautiful national park. And I don't have any way to get that message across. No one's at all interested in hearing that message. And I can't in any way have any kind of influence over making that message be heard and work on. What's going to happen is, and what does happen, it happens here, it happens in Maine, is that corporate leaders, they get access to the legislators. And they can say things like, and this won't hurt the lakes, and this won't hurt the air, and this won't bother the car. And none of that is true. But I'm on the other end of seeing exactly on a day by day level the changes that are happening to our government, and it's not good. Really need to take this very, very seriously and push back on these corporations and make sure that they do not get the everything because we are all afraid. Thank you.
I just wanted to clarify that.
No, sir, this is Bill. I had a question that I proposed for the group. So let me spend a minute to explain the question and then I'll ask the question. Here's the media that I reflect on this, that when they start to speak on how our society evolved from a very intimate society, now we're evolving into a postmodern digital society, thinking about the artificial intelligence, the robots, and so forth. And I'm also aware of the increasing prevalence of concentrated money in our elections. So my question is this. I think people see a nexus between this influx of money in this changing technology landscape that will cause us to rethink how the governance.
I want to be sure that I understood something that Bill said at the beginning of the meeting. Bill, is it correct that that everything on the Google Drive will be readable by the public?
Yes.
Great. Thank you.
Thanks very much. So let me thank the commissioners who are here on the phone for coming. Let me thank you, Dragons, for your thoughtful